الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. I would like first to thank the Islamic Society of UWS and the efforts put forward to host this lecture tonight. Actually, it's very important, the topic we chose for tonight. It's about true friendship. True friendship in Islam, how to select the true friend. And there is a choice that many people these days do not do it right. In fact, choosing the wrong friend can lead to your destruction. For that reason, a friend is a great pressure and consequently can lead to your miserable end. You might be introduced to drugs in this life, you might be introduced to alcohol and other forbidden things. But trust me, a bad friend could lead to even more than this. A bad friend will influence you bit after bit. It's like giving you poison drop by drop without realizing you find yourself that your body has become fully poisoned. For that reason, this topic is very, very important, especially for you as students of universities, and you make connections with people. That is very important to keep in mind. So we'll talk about this topic. I don't have to identify who Darul Fatwa is. Darul Fatwa, briefly, is the High Islamic Council of Australia. It represents more than 35 Islamic organizations and more than 80 imams across all Australia. And it gives me privilege to be part of this organization, as its main purpose is to make sure that the voice of Muslims is reaching as far as we can, not any voice, rather the voice of moderation and the voice of the proper teachings of Islam. We'll start with this ayah, and I want you to focus at the meaning of this ayah. Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, Al-akhillau yawma'idhim ba'duhum li ba'din adu illa al-muttaqeen. So this ayah in Surat Az-Zukhruf means those who were friends in this life will be enemies on the day of judgment, except those who were pious. Just remember this. If the friends are not pious, if they gather on something other than piety, then this seemingly friendship will turn into enmity on the day of judgment. And Allah Azza wa Jal is telling us in this ayah that those friends in this life will turn into enemies on the day of judgment, unless those are pious. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us in this ayah that those who were pious, that's what is understood from the ayah, and they were friends on piety, the love to one another on the day of judgment, and their companionship will definitely remain and increase. So we need to know what is piety to make sure if you are pious or your friend is pious. How do you evaluate yourself and you evaluate your friend? You need to understand what piety means. Piety is defined as fulfilling the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and refraining from all the prohibitions. So if you perform all the obligations, you pray properly, you fast properly. If you are obligated to perform Hajj, you perform Hajj properly. You pay the due zakah and so on. You perform all the obligations and you learn the obligatory knowledge, which is part of the obligations, and you avoid all the sins. By that you become a pious slave. And those who are pious, they treat people with kindness. And they are honest in their Islamically approved dealings. They also cooperate with one another to perform what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts. And they get together to do what is obedient to Allah azza wa jal. Just think of all these. If you make a checklist of all these points that we listed here, then you can evaluate your friends. Do they perform the obligations? Do they avoid the sins? Do they cooperate with one another in what is obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Make that checklist and check if they are pious or not. So the pious friend is the one who guides you to goodness and to the good deeds that will benefit you in the hereafter. That's the pious friend. The pious friend would advise you as well and warn you if you commit a sin, because he wishes you to be religiously well. So he's looking after your religious health. And that is more important than your physical health. Some people might be sick. They go to the doctor, they want treatment. They got cancer in the stomach. They are worried. So even in worst case scenario, they die from that cancer that is spread in the stomach. Islamically, they die as martyrs, shuhada. And this is called shahidul akhirah, the martyr of the hereafter. This person will be forgiven. Even if he used to commit major sins in this life, because he died in this type of martyrdom, will be forgiven on the day of judgment, and hence will be admitted into paradise without receiving any punishment. So to be physically unwell, it doesn't mean you're going to end up in a bad situation. No. If you die with a type of martyrdom, sickness in the stomach, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, you die with plague, you die with some other types like drowning, for instance, you die as a martyr, and that's called shaheed, shaheedul akhirah, and you will be forgiven on the day of judgment. But the one who looks after your religious situation, that is more important. Because even if your doctor, let us say, neglected you, didn't look after you properly, didn't give you that attention to your health, you ended up dying. You die as a believer at least. And if you were pious, you'll be admitted into paradise without receiving any punishment. But what about your friend who is guiding you to be religiously well? That is more important. So if you have such a friend, this is a great endowment. To have a friend that reminds you of being obedient to Allah Azza wa Jal. Not the one that just wants to have fun, hanging around, spending some time here, some time there. Let's go fishing, let's go hunting, let's go to the beach. Let's go to that place and to that place, wasting your time. If you think about it, this is not a good friend for you. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said what means. The believer is like a mirror to his brother. Now, this means if you look in the mirror, you'll be able to see what? To see any defects in your face. Let us say you have something here, a dirt, whatever. When you look in the mirror, you can see it and you get rid of it. So the mirror reveals your defects. The Muslim brother should be like a mirror to his Muslim brother. Meaning he will show him, guide him to his defects. He will tell him what you're doing is wrong. As if he's looking in the mirror. He will be telling him, advising him, because he wants the best for him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith mentioned to us the importance of being advising to each other. So if you find a friend who is advising, don't lose him. This is a great endowment. If you find, my sister, a friend that will guide you to what is beneficial for you in the hereafter, don't lose that friend. That's a great endowment. Now, when you look in the mirror, you're supposed to see what? To see yourself. But you see any defect in your face, in your body, you'll be able to see it when you look in the mirror. Don't expect the mirror to reflect a different image. It's going to reflect your image. So whatever you have defects in your body, in your face, you'll be able to see them. That's the true mirror. Otherwise, it's not a mirror. That's the real projection of yourself, of your body. When it comes to advising each other, you expect your friend to be telling you exactly what is in you. You don't expect that friend to be approving you in all your actions just because he doesn't want to lose you as a friend. That's not a friend. That is dangerous to be around you, to be honest. So the pious friend is the one who loves you for the sake of Allah. That's why. He's not worried about money to be lost. He's not looking forward to marry your sister. And that's why he's trying to be close to you. And he doesn't need any other worldly matter from you. And for that reason, he is befriending you. When you have a true friend, the true friend loves you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have compiled this story for you with some pictures that are approximate, just to give you an idea. It's about Prophet Isa alayhi salam. It's called the greed that happened to a person and what are the consequences of the greed that he had and the three loaves of bread for us to learn from it. Now it was mentioned that Prophet Isa alayhi salam, I'll summarize it, was with a person and they were walking. And as you know, because Prophet Isa alayhi salam was full of blessings and he used to perform miracles by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, some people would like to stay with him, hang around with him to get from these blessings. One person was with him one day and they reached a river bank and they sat to eat some bread. So Prophet Isa alayhi salam had three loaves of bread. He took one for himself and he gave one to that man and he left one aside. So Prophet Isa alayhi salam ate his loaf, that man ate his. Then Prophet Isa alayhi salam left that person to get some water. When he came back, he didn't see that third loaf. So he asked the man, where did it go? That man said, I don't know anything about it. when in fact that man took it and ate it. But he lied. He said, I don't know anything about it. So they went forth. Then they reached a forest where they saw Adi with her two baby fawns. Prophet Isa alayhi salam pointed to one of them to come to him. And it came. It surrendered itself to Prophet Isa alayhi salam. Prophet Isa alayhi salam slaughtered that Adi and they cooked that meat and they ate from it. After they finished, Prophet Isa alayhi salam looked at it, some bones, that's what is left from that Adi that was slaughtered and cooked, and said to it, get up by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the power of Allah. And it was revived. It was brought back to life. So that was a miracle that Prophet Isa alayhi salam was supported with. That man saw this miracle. Then Prophet Isa alayhi salam said to him, you have seen this miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported me with. Then I'm asking you now, who took that loaf? I ask you by Allah Azza wa Jal, the one who enabled this slaughtered deer to come back to life. Who ate that loaf? And then he insisted in lying and he said, I don't know. Then Prophet Isa alayhi salam continued. He knew that that person will continue what? Denying. They reached a place where they saw a deserted area with a lot of sand in it. So he gathered a big pile of sand and said to it, be gold by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. So it turned into real gold. So that sand turned into real gold. Then Prophet Isa alayhi salam divided that amount of gold into three shares. He said, this is for me, and the other one is for you, and the third one is for the one who took the loaf. Then that man, looking at this big amount of gold, he said, I'm the one who took it. So now he admitted that he was the one who took that loaf. Then Prophet Isa alayhi salam said to him, take him all, I don't want him. And he left him. He went, then that person was gathering this amount of gold. He doesn't know what to do with it. Then suddenly he was approached by two thieves. Now the two thieves came to him and they wanted to kill him. He said to them, don't kill me. Let us divide them into three shares. Each one will take a portion. They agreed, instead of killing him, to divide them into three shares. Then those two thieves, one of them said to his co-partner, let's go buy some food first. Let us eat. Then after that, we can start dividing. It's a mission to divide that big amount of gold. So they said, okay, go and buy us some food. He went. That was his friend, his co-partner in stealing. So he went to the village to buy some food. The other two who were left behind plotted to kill that person. They said, why should we divide this amount of gold into three shares? We can kill him when he comes back and we can divide them into two shares only. So they plotted for him. Now that person who went to the village, he was thinking the same. So he said, why should I share this amount of gold amongst the three? I'll put poison in the food, kill him, and by doing so, I'll take the whole amount of gold. So he did that. Once he came back and they saw him, they ran towards him and they attacked him and killed him. And they sat down laughing and eating, and instantly they died from the poison. So now we are left with what? A pile of gold and three corpses, three dead bodies. Prophet Isa alayhi salam came back with some of his companions and he saw this scene, shocking scene. And Prophet Isa alayhi salam said to his companions, This is an example of those who want the worldly matters in this life. So those who are friends in this life can lose each other at any time. Money can split them. Money can split them. Any conflict between them will turn them into enemies. And I'll mention this story for you. In one of the Arab countries, there were two friends, and they were very close to each other, that they would say, this is a shadow of that person. They would go to every lesson together, to the mosque, they go together. If there is any function, you see him together, always, going and coming. Very close friends. Then one day, they decided to what? They decided to make business together. They went into partnership. And they invested thousands of dollars. And it reached millions even. They started having troubles and troubles, and they ended up turning into the worst enemies to each other. They became worst enemies to each other, that they don't want to see each other, they don't want to talk to each other. And everyone is wishing for the other one the bad thing to happen to him. That's after being what? Very close. One of the righteous Muslims who knew about the situation, he said, جَمَعَهُمُ الدِّينَ وَفَرَّقَتْهُمُ الدُّنْيَا. The religion brought them together, but the dunya split them apart. So that's why religion brings people together, but the worldly matters will split them apart. For that reason, you have to make sure that your friend, what you call a friend, is one who is wishing you the best Islamically. Not the one who just wants to hang around with you. Maybe he wants to benefit from you financially. Or he has any other worldly target he's looking at. Now that's not a friend. The true friend is the one who advises you to prepare yourself to the hereafter. He acts like an alarm, reminding you of the hereafter. Pray, fast, go to the lesson. That's the true friend. Both Al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated from the root of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ayatul Munafiqi Salas, Iza haddasa kazab, وَإِذَا وَعَدَ أَخْلَفْ وَإِذَا تُمِنَ خَانْ. So this hadith means three matters are the sign of the hypocrite. So if you want to know the hypocrite in actions, these are the signs. He lies when he speaks. Second, he breaks his promise. Third and last, he betrays the trust. So if you see in someone these signs, you know that this person is a hypocrite. Based on this hadith, it is clear that every Muslim should be truthful and honest in his speech, faithful in his promise, and trustworthy in carrying out that which he has been entrusted with. He does not deceive or defraud. He does not tell lies, and hence he is not a hypocrite. Therefore, truthfulness and honesty are one of the chief good qualities, whereas falsehood is a sign of corruption and evil. Moreover, honesty keeps one far away from evil, bad deeds, and sickness of the heart. You don't know what would happen to a person when his heart is sick. I'm not talking physically now, medically, I'm talking Islamically. If you have problem in your heart religiously, that will reflect on your organs and limbs, because the heart is the commander of the organs. If the heart is healthy, the whole body will be healthy. If the heart is corrupted, then the whole body will be corrupted. So honesty is a noble trait and a sign of good mannerism. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to be honest. Allah ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ وَكُونُوا مَعَ الصَّادِقِينَ Fear Allah Azza wa Jal and be with the honest people. Be with them. Hang around with them. Why? So you can learn from them. You become one of them, an honest person. So we are urged to emulate the honest people in matters like honoring oaths and in all of their affairs, especially honesty. In doing so, there is benefit and safety in this life and in the hereafter. That's the benefit of having honest friends. Al-Bukhari and Muslim narrated through the route of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah raise his rank, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, truthfulness leads to piety, and piety leads to paradise. A man will continue speaking the truth until he is written as being truthful. In explaining this hadith, the scholar said, he will be famous by his truthfulness amongst the angels of the skies and amongst people on earth. So people will talk about this person and his honesty. So we'll be famous with this matter. But on the other hand, lying leads to very abhorrent sins, which lead to hellfire. A man will continue lying until he is recorded as a liar. Instead of being famous with honesty, he will be infamous for being what? Dishonest. So amongst people, people will repel away from him, and also he will be known amongst the angels of the skies as being a dishonest person. An example of this is the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لا تصاحب إلا مؤمنا. Do not befriend but a pious person. It's not haram to befriend other than a pious person. However, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is urging us to have a pious friend. For what reason? Because it's better for you. As I mentioned, having a bad friend could be more destructive to you than being exposed to some nuclear reactions sometimes and radiations. They say that people might be influenced from these radiations for years. Yeah, but if you have a bad friend, he will drag you slowly. Then you find yourself amid what? Amid the mud. You find it very difficult to come out of it and to clean yourself. And that one, the devil puts all his effort to convince you that that's it, that's your situation. You can't get out of this muddy place. You are contaminated with mud, so you cannot clean yourself. And he will convince him that that's his destiny, and to stay like this till the end of his life. That's the pressure. And he finds around himself all those bad influences around him that will pressure him to do what? To continue in that wrong way. He ends up being killed, shot, or in jail for the rest of his life. That's from the peer pressure. That's why you select the true friends to be around you, those who will guide you and not those who will drag you to the wrong places, and to be as well to end up in hellfire. You don't want these people. Those are not friends. I hear this word from many young ladies and young men when they say about someone, that's my best friend. If you call him a best friend, is he really a best friend? If you evaluate him or her, you want to put that checklist, I'm sure maybe you don't find that person reaching the minimum of being considered a friend. Not a best friend. Just to be considered a friend, he's not even a friend. He could be an enemy to you. That's why you have to realize what you are doing. And you need to evaluate those around you. Adhere to those who are true friends and stay away from those who would give you a bad influence. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, "Al-mar'u 'ala din khalilihi falyanzur ahadukum man yukhalil." What does it mean? The person will be influenced greatly by his peers. So let one be very cautious when picking these friends whom he wants to see around him. When the Prophet said, "Al-mar'u 'ala din khalilihi," meaning one will be influenced by his peer, by his friend, to an extent that you become a copy of him. You become a copy of him. That's why if you hang around with good people, it's expected that you will become a good person. If you hang around with drug dealers and drugs addicts and the like, it's expected to be one of them. Many young guys told me they selected that way, the drugs, then they repented to Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah guided them. Yeah, one of them said to me that I went to bring someone back to the religion and he dragged me to that path. So he was trying to bring him to religion and he was lost. That's not an easy thing. That's why you need to be worried about yourself. See, sometimes when in a very cold weather, if you have shower and you want to go out, you say, I want to wear some clothes, make sure I cover my head, I don't want to be sick. So you take all these precautions because you don't want to catch that disease. Could be flu, cold, whatever, something very simple that would last for a few days and that's it. So what about hanging around with some people that will make a bad influence? So they might, as you can see in the picture, drag you to taking drugs, you become one of them. And sometimes you need to look at what? The friend of your friend. Because you might have a friend and you're hanging around with him and you say, yeah, I know he's a good person. If your precautions are 90%, your friend might have up to 60%. The friend of that friend will have up to 20%. So the friend of your friend might be taking drugs, dealing with drugs. So you hang around with your friend, and the friend of your friend will eventually become your friend. That's in many cases. A friend of a friend becomes your friend because you hang around with each other and see what happens in the end. Once you get stuck in drugs, and drugs are expensive, if you want to take the cheap quality ones, they call them, that will destroy you quickly, like the ecstasy pills, the ice, whatever, all these things that you know, they end up what? Destroying you. That's why you need to look at those who are around you. If they are good people, then they're worthy to be befriended. If not, leave him. Don't say, I know him. Even if that is your cousin, even if he is related to you, if you know that he is a bad influence, stay away from them. And please do not think that you are a superhero, where you say, I know myself, I'm very strong, no one would affect me. Yeah, I know a person who said that, these same words. He ended up working as a security guard outside one of the clubs in Sydney. Outside. When we told him, you can't do this type of job, stay away from it. Don't be in that situation, in that place. He said, I know myself. From being outside, he ended up inside. Not only that, he started taking drugs, drinking alcohol, fornicating, and the like, whatever sins you can imagine that could be done in that place. He thought he is a superhero. He can defend himself, he can protect himself, he can face all these waves of sins that are approaching him. Trust me, it's like, you know what? It's like someone is under a big waterfall. He wants to go through it. And he says, yeah, I know I have an umbrella. So when I go under it, I know myself, I have an umbrella. What that umbrella would do in front of this big amount of water that is falling down, that won't protect you. So don't think you are a superhero and you just push yourself, yeah, I want to see what they do. I want to be with them, just I want to observe. No, you're going to end up dragged. Because trust me, these days are called the days of tsunami of seditions, tribulations, and sins. Tsunami is everywhere. So once you get out of your house, it's like a big current sweeping people away. When you have the knowledge of the religion, you can manage to reach the mosque without being swifted away with that current or tsunami of sins that will take place. So keep that in mind. Not only that, what is worse than all these sins that we mentioned is the wrong mentality and wrong ideology that has been planted in many hearts, instilled in many hearts of young Muslims to an extent that they reached a stage where they believe that their parents are non-Muslims, their brothers and sisters are not Muslims, and they think that Islam is only present amongst a very small group of people, those who are killing Muslims under the name of Islam, wal-ayyadu billahi ta'ala. This wrong ideology that poisoned the hearts and the mentality of many young people made them go travel to kill other Muslims, to slaughter them, to commit suicide bombing, where in marketplaces, where men, women, children, elderly will be in that place, they don't care. In weddings, in Jordan it happened in a wedding. Muslims were having a wedding. Yeah, one person went inside and he blew up himself. Wedding for Muslims. So what is he doing in that place? He killed himself, he killed others as well, other Muslims, and he turned that wedding into a funeral. So this wrong mentality that could poison your mind and your way of thinking and the way you look at other Muslims, that is very dangerous. That will take you to to a stage where that's it. That's what they tell them. You are the only Muslims, and the rest of the Muslims around the world are non-Muslims. That's what they tell them. But they are very minority. Now, some people are talking about a number of 30,000. 30,000, if you're good in mathematics, those attributed to Islam these days are more than 1.6 billion. More than this number. So put 30,000 over 1.6 billion, what would you get? They are insignificant number. They're not worthy to be mentioned. It's like an ant in front of a big mountain. It's nothing. But unfortunately, they poison the minds of many people, unfortunately. Your friend, and that's what you need to think about it, will either drag you to paradise or to hellfire. Your friend will either take you to the high ranks or to the lowest of the levels. That's what would a friend do. It was said, As-sahib, sahib. Imma ila al-jannah wa imma ila al-nar. He will drag you either to paradise or to hellfire. To that extent, when you think about it, you know, how important and how careful you should be when selecting a friend. If that friend will be a reason for you to be dragged into hellfire, how important it is for you to select that good friend. It's like, imagine you have two pills. The doctor put two pills in front of you. And he said to you, this one will make you better. This one will kill you. This one will kill you. Then you look at the color of these tablets, for instance. If you forget, you will ask. And before you take it, you say, I want to be sure which one is the one that will help me. You need to ask. Otherwise, you might take the wrong one and you'll end up dying. So when picking friends, you have to be very cautious. Trust me, you might know many people, but that doesn't mean everyone that you know, you want to befriend him or her, for instance. Not everyone you know is worthy to be a friend. When you say a friend, meaning a mirror, as we mentioned, as the Prophet mentioned. It was said in Arabic, صديقك من صدقك لا من صدقك. صديقك من صدقك. The true friend is the one who is honest with you in his advice. In the way he talks to you, he's honest. Not the one who approves you in everything you do. That's not a friend. If you say to him, I want to take some drugs. And he says, yes, do it. I'm thinking of taking a sip of alcohol. Then he would say, do it. That's not a friend. This is one of the helpers of the devil, of Satan, in the shape of a human being. He is a helper of the devil. So he will put some influence on you to make you a bad person. And remember this, the ultimate goal of Satan in this life is to make you die as a non-believer. He tries by his nails and teeth. He puts all his efforts just to make you die as a non-believer. That's why if you start committing sins, Satan will get his supporters, the other devils, to go to that person and convince him to stay the way he is. That's why sometimes we found difficulty bringing some people back. Once they go off the track, it's very difficult to bring them back. You need to keep talking to convince them. You need to show them. And some people, will come back to the right track when suddenly they hear of one of their friends who died in a car accident, died from overdosing the drugs. How hard it is. Then they wake up and they know that this path will take me to that end, although they know from the beginning. But subhanAllah, the devil decorates the sins, as you know. Decorates the sin, even if there is something very, very, very ugly, Satan will decorate it for you to make you accept it. But the one who is knowledgeable, the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will know that this is not good for me, he would stay away from it. No matter what decoration is on it, he will stay away from it. So picking the right friend is a mission. And if you are unsure about someone, yeah, do not befriend him. Put a distance. And just keep that in mind. It doesn't mean that everyone you get to meet or to know, that means he has to be your friend. No, doesn't have to be that way. Now, what are the virtues and merits of truthfulness and honesty? So that's for you to try to adopt these qualities and also to encourage others to be honest and truthful. Truthfulness unveils the good qualities and the sincere intentions of a person. Allah promised the truthful person with great returns and rewards in this world and in the hereafter. In this world, the truthful person will be rewarded with the acceptance of Allah, al-rida, and the love of people as well as the trust in Him. The honest person benefits himself and others. He will also be relieved from the calamities that befall liars, because sometimes when a person lies, then he gets exposed after that. He'll definitely carry the consequences. He will pay for his lying. It's not going to go without consequences. Tranquility and peace will encompass his mind and heart, because you know you say the truth. But the one who lies is always worried about what? Being exposed in the future. And for that reason, I give you this advice and learn from me. Do not hide something like this from your parents. Even if you find, because your parents usually are the ones that want the best for you. So if they are Islamically knowledgeable, don't hide anything. If something bad happens to you, go to them, tell them, such and such happened today. They can help you. Before it becomes worse. It's like someone, let us say, is stuck in a sand pit, for instance, and he is drowning bit after bit, but he's not calling for help. Now it reaches up to his ankles, he's not calling for help, up to his knees, his waist, his shoulders. After that, he won't be able to call. He's drowned completely. So that's why you don't leave it till the last minute, because it might be too late. They might not be able to help you at that time. The Messenger of Allah, may Allah raise his rank, emphasized the importance of one being honest and trustworthy in all one's affairs, including buying and selling, and promise such a person with great rewards in the hereafter. Among these rewards is that the honest tradesperson will be assembled on the day for judgment with the prophets, highly righteous Muslims, and martyrs. This hadith was narrated by At-Tirmidhi. Why would that truthful tradesperson be assembled on the day for judgment with the prophets, the martyrs, and the highly ranked Muslims, because it wasn't an easy mission for him. To show honesty and truthfulness when selling and buying, that needs a big of effort to confront the devil and to go against your bad inclinations. As for the reward of honesty in the hereafter, the honest people will be highly accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal, and they will be in the highest levels of paradise. The enjoyment therein is what no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard of, and no human has ever imagined. Ayah 119 of Surah Al-Ma'idah means, this is the day, that's in reference to the day of judgment, when the truthful will benefit from their truthfulness. For them are gardens in paradise, beneath which rivers flow, wherein they will dwell forever. Indeed, Allah has accepted them, and they devotedly submitted themselves to Allah, and that is the great success. We ask Allah to make us amongst them. Take a case study, Indonesia. Despite its great population, more than 200 million are Muslims in Indonesia. It's the biggest Islamic country. It's not an Arabic country, by the way, but that's the biggest Islamic country. So you might be thinking of, let us say, Egypt. Yeah, Egypt over 80 million. Let us say the Muslims are 70 million. But Indonesia is the biggest Islamic country. Yeah, these countries were not conquered by a sword. No fight happened in the past. Rather, honest tradesmen from Hadramaut, from Yemen, used to travel to that region to make some trade with people there. People saw their honesty, truthfulness, and they loved their manners, and they knew that Islam promotes and urges one to have these manners, and that pushed them toward to embrace Islam. The biggest Islamic country. So they responded to their call because they noticed these Muslim tradesmen had desirable attributes. They saw honesty, good manners, and a good way of dealing with others. Unfortunately, these days, we don't have that situation. Unfortunately, most of the Muslims are not dealing with others with honesty, good manners, and being kind to others. And if the tradesmen had the same attributes of the Muslims today, they wouldn't have conquered this country. Unfortunately, that's sad. So our final word of advice to all of you. If you know that your Muslim brother or sister has not learned the matters of the religion, has not learned the obligations, and is not aware of the forbidden matters, then your duty is what? Not to leave them the way they are. Don't leave them. Try to help them. And that's classified as a good friend. You will be a good friend to others in that case. Try to help them survive. Don't leave them the way they are. And also advise them with wisdom for the sake of Allah. Don't be so tough on them in a way that they will repel away from accepting the truth or the advice from you. Try to be nice. Approach them in a very, very nice way. So by that you can gain them. They can become guided, and you will be the reason for their guidance. So you will be rewarded. Just imagine if you dragged him to praying, then all the rewards he gets for his prayer, that would be for him. And a similar, not exactly the same, similar reward will come to you as well. So as long as that person is praying till the end of his life, you will be rewarded for that as well. If you guided him to fast and he started fasting, every year he fasts, you will be getting rewards from this. Imagine if you guide 10 people, 20 people. The Prophet ﷺ said, if you can make one person guided by you and he embraces Islam because of you, that would be better to you than this whole world and all the pleasures in it. Just one person. That's what you want. That's what you want. And that's what the Sahaba used to fight for. One of the companions had a disagreement with another companion. And what he owed him is what is a tree. Tree that grew in his land and he wanted to benefit by it. And then that person wanted it for himself. He asked him to sell it for him. He said, I won't sell it. He requested to pay money for it in exchange of that tree. He refused. He didn't want to sell a tree. They ended up going to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet said, sell it to him. Why don't you sell it to him? He's ready to pay this amount of money. He said, I won't sell it to him. Because that is to me, is given such and such, so I'm not thinking of selling it. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, who would buy it and give it to that person and will be granted a palace in paradise? A house in paradise, palace. One of the companions came and said to him, what do you know about my garden? It's actually like an orchard, big orchard, big place. And he had many trees and big house in it. Then that person said, I haven't heard of a garden nicer than yours. A house that is nicer than your house. And the trees that are in that orchard, I haven't seen anything like this. So I know they are the best. He said, would you accept all that in exchange for this tree? Then that person said, yes, I'll take it. He said, that's yours. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, who would buy it and will have paradise? He gave this big orchard with the house in it, with the trees, for the sake of what? Of gaining paradise. And look, Prophet Isa alayhi salam gave away that gold. He didn't want it. The Prophet's hearts are attached to the hereafter. The righteous Muslims' hearts are attached to the hereafter, not to this worldly thing. So if you find yourself, what you think about making money, doing such and such, that's a dangerous situation. Live your life in a very humble way and dedicate your time to the hereafter. By this, you win. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So that's our final statement to you. Be wise and choose your friend wisely. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us in paradise, inshaAllah azza wa jal, and to make us in the shade of the arsh on the day of judgment, when there is no shade except for the shade of the arsh. We ask Allah azza wa jal to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge that we have acquired, and make us amongst those who practice the knowledge they have acquired, and Allah knows best. And for this intention, inshaAllah azza wa jal, let us all recite Surat Al-Fatiha.